right, Big Bev in the building, in the flesh, the man, the myth, the legend, Seisha Moise, the legend herself. We are inside another episode of Hustle. Big Bev had a few technical issues, but yeah. You know what? He got through it. And before we go any further, if I even introduce the show and what it's about, Bev is officially, yeah, drawing comparison to CR7. You know, when you got a leap like that,
Apparently so.
I don't want to hear all this apparently stuff, bro. From time it's on the internet, it's official. Yeah. It's bona fide. But no, that's big. How are you, man? How was your day?
Not too bad. I was in, we had a game on Wednesday. So I had yesterday off. I was in today for a recovery session. And yeah, that was it, to be honest with you. Done an extra bit of gym in the afternoon just to take over. And yeah, man, we haven't got a game this weekend, so we're in tomorrow morning.
Okay, extra sessions and that. I hear you, man. All right, cool. So, Hustle, everyone that's listening, if this is your first time, shame on you. It's basically a show understanding the hustles, the investments, the businesses of some of your favorite footballers / athletes. Because there's a common stat that floats around out there that around 40% of players, after they retire, actually go bankrupt. And so myself and Sage thought, rah, firstly, that's a mad stat. And secondly, let's actually speak to these ballers and find out what they're doing to make sure they're not part of that statistic. So that's where we're at today. My name's James Rogers Oban, aka the Brand Plug, and I'm here with Seisha Moise. She's going to introduce herself now.
You just introduce me.
You don't want to say nothing else? All right. Do you? yeah, man, let's get into it, Bev. So for people that don't know you, what we like to do is to give you your platform to give yourself a little introduction. So you have 1 minute, just one minute. To tell us about you, your journey, your come up, no longer than a minute. Yeah?
Okay.
I'm even going to put a timer on. All right. Sure. 3, 2, 1. Let's get into it.
As Oban just said, my name is Bevis Mugabi, born and bred from Harrow, and started off my football career playing for my local team in Norfolk called Last Mile Rovers. Then got scouted by a team called IFA, which is a Fulham Development Centre. After that, I was there for a year or so. I got a trial with Fulham Football Club and they signed me after a 6-week trial. After that, they let me go, they released me, and I eventually signed for Southampton Football Club, where I signed a 1-year scholarship, a 2-year pro. Then after that, I extended my stay for another 2 years. Then after that, I went to Yeovil Town in Somerset. I was there for 3 years. Then after that, I managed to play for my national team, Uganda, in the African Cup of Nations.
Okay.
Then shortly after that, I signed for Motherwell Football Club. So that's where I am. That's where I'm at right now.
That's I like me. That. 6 seconds to spare. I like that.
Breathing space. Like
let's get
I'm glad you mentioned Southampton, Bev, because I was looking online, doing a bit of research, and I got a little quote for you. It says, I played against Sadio Mane in the last 16, and that was a good experience. I think he's still in my pocket.
Yeah, I think he's still there, to be honest with you.
Check, make sure.
You standing by that, yeah?
Pardon?
You standing by that?
Yeah, I'd like to say so. I thought I had a good game against him. But one that, obviously, I was joking at the time, but when I did say it, it kind of blew up, and like all the newspapers, local newspapers are just getting on to me saying, oh, Bevis Mugabi really thinks he's Sadio Mane in his pocket. I was like, come on, man, it's just a joke. But, you know, media people just tried to make a story out of nothing, pretty much. But yeah, it was funny when I said that at the time, for sure.
Must have been a good experience playing with him at Southampton.
Yeah, definitely. He was one of the senior or pros there that really like looked after the younger players and like took time out of his day to come and like speak to us when we were in training, being brought up to the first team to train with them, who always talk to us and say, yeah, do this, do that, do this. So he was definitely one of the good ones, for sure.
I hear it still. And I think we'll start with Southampton then, because you were one of the first men from ends. You just get a scholar, bro. You got the 2-year pro as well. So that was brazy. What was it like getting that first contract? And did you remember anything, any big purchases where you thought, rah, I've arrived there. It's time to take mummy shopping. Like any big purchases straight off the bat?
I think, like, I was first surprised when I got the actual pro, because I came or got let go from Fulham. Then they said, oh, we're going to sign you. We're going to offer you a scholarship and a professional contract, which took me back. I was like, oh, I wasn't expecting that.
Mm.
Of course, you're on your scholar wage, which is like, I don't know, nothing pretty much. 130, I think, it might have been a week or something like that. Yeah, when when your pro kicks in and you're seeing like a lot more than that.
That's a lot more.
Yeah, you see a lot more. You're like, bloody hell, like, what do I actually do this? But, so me personally, I was into trainers, so I'll literally just buy any sort of trainers, like anything, pretty much.
Yeah.
Luckily, my mom was onto me, African parent, like, Bevis, like, okay, you're earning this amount at a very young age, like 17.
Yeah.
And she was like, you have to put some money away. So I was very lucky in that sense. And my brother, being an accountant as well, and just clued up. He just said, yeah, just always put, as long as you put this amount of money away, then eventually in the coming years, you can work with it. But I think like the first big purchase that, definitely the first big purchase that I made was my Vauxhall Corsa.
Okay, I remember that still.
Definitely the Vauxhall Corsa, for sure. Oh, I had some good journeys in that. And the insurance, which obviously...
That's the thing that killed you, yeah.
It was you. My insurance was more than the actual car.
And the whip itself, yeah.
Yeah.
But you're so young, and also you're just doing mileage, bro.
Yeah, I'm doing mileage, and obviously I want to be legit with my insurance, so I put down that I was a professional footballer.
Okay.
So as soon as you say that,
it goes
to the roof.
Skyrocketing.
Yeah, that was a big surprise when I actually, like, for a Vauxhall Corsa, which was like a couple years old, I was like, surely you're going to make me pay that amount for it? So I had to take that hit big time and just roll it. So that was probably the biggest purchase that I've made.
And what about your most expensive pair of trainers, given you like them so much?
I would say, if you remember, like the high Balenciagas, kind of like leather ones.
Like, I remember them still.
Yeah, I had a couple of them. Those are probably the most expensive, to be honest with you. But luckily, I kind of grew out of that trainer phase pretty quickly.
Yeah. See, when you're at Southampton now, so that's a Premier League club, and so you're surrounded by like real, real money men. Like, what were they like? What were they like in terms of influencing you? Were they men on just buying bottles, doing the most, or the people getting your ear as well?
I would say, obviously, being like 18, legally allowed to go out to clubs, this and the other, you'd bump into like the odd first team player that's out as well, same night. Big coincidence. Bevis, come to our table. I've got you. Yeah. And you just see just bottles flying around the thinking, rah, like, this is a bit crazy.
Bro, give us numbers. Are them man doing mad numbers? Like, do you ever remember one night when you were like, hey, listen, I can't believe I'm from Harrow?
I wouldn't say crazy numbers to them. Well, maybe to me, or definitely crazy numbers. But to them, it's just like a normal weekend, which was scary for me at that age. And it was kind of difficult at the time because you could see like some of the players that I was playing with at the time tried to like live up to that and try to like resemble them and try that to compete with them in a way, which was kind of unfortunate for them. But I was seeing it at the time. I was like, nah, I can't do that. I can't. But it was very interesting. Very, very interesting.
I hear you still.
Yeah, man. No crazy numbers though. From when I was going out of Southampton for sure.
So sensible thing.
Pardon?
On the sensible thing.
On the sensible. But when like I heard stories of them going into London and spending like tens, 15,000 on like a night out, I'm thinking, wow, these guys have really, really made it.
Mm.
You know.
So you never got anywhere close to that.
Oh, impossible. No way.
5, 4, 3, what?
No.
What do you reckon you
throw
on a night out?
On a night out, Oban knows me. I'm a bit tight.
You're more than tight. Still. That's one way to put it. Still,
I'm a bit tight. But if like all my guys are there, then I'll buy like a bottle or so. Then all of us can enjoy it all together. Oban knows that.
Fact still. All right, cool. All right. So apart from just like spending your money frivolously, obviously there were men in there that were also potentially investing in big things. Was there anyone that was investing in anything or saying, "Rah, Bev, do X, Y, Z"? Like in terms of change room behavior towards peas, what's that like? And then anyone saying, "Put your money towards this," and you actually listen to them?
Well, I've had a few conversations with Jose Fonte And because obviously he played in my position at the time and he was giving me advice on and off the pitch. Mm. And he always said, just try getting the property ladder as soon as possible.
Okay.
And I'm having like similar conversations with my older brother at that time as well. And that's what we done. We both put money together and bought a place in London.
What, you and Fonte or you and your bro?
Me and my brother.
Okay.
Brother.
Okay.
And we put our money together and just bought a place in London at the time because I was based in Southampton, I had my own place there. And I was like, I've got like this lump of money just sitting in my account. Like, what's the point of it just being there? Just, it's a nice number to look at, but what's it actually doing for me? You know?
What?
I just had a conversation with my brothers, like, yeah, like, let's do something. Can we just find a place for a good price? And we just went for it. And yeah, we're just renting out as we speak.
What area is it?
It's in South London.
Okay. And is it just the one you have right now, or are you planning to like branch out?
Yeah, I'm planning to branch out. Well, right now I'm in a difficult, not, I don't say a difficult situation, but just a decision that I have to make whether to buy a place for myself in the future, like a family home that I can see myself living in long term.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Buy like, I don't know, a couple flats, which I can invest in as an investment. So that's the kind of situation I'm in at the moment, for sure.
And I'm sure like many other people might be thinking a similar thing. So can you go through some of the things that you might be thinking, like pros and cons wise, and what might help you come to your decision?
Next contract, location of my next club that I'm going to be at, if it's going to be in Scotland, if it's going to be in London, Manchester, could be anywhere, could be out of the country even, like me now in Scotland. So I think those are the main decisions that I'm going to have to be making pretty soon in the next couple of months, to be honest.
I hear you still. And you see, when you're thinking of your next contract, do you always see it, yeah? I always find this interesting. Do you see it as like a lump sum? So say you're on a 2.5-year deal, you're getting X amount a month. You think, rah, the contract's worth this much, so that means I'm nice like that? Or do you think of it, like you break it down monthly and you're like, okay, this is how I have to manage my P's on a monthly basis?
For me, I do it on a monthly basis because it changes every month with like bonuses, win bonuses, clean sheet bonus, everything like changes within the month that you're going to get. So it just depends on how well I've done, really. If I've done really well, then I can put more money aside to do this, money to aside to do this with my mom or my brother, for myself personally. So with my friend. So yeah, just that's the way I look at it, to be honest.
I hear that still. So you mentioned brethrens. Have you like gone into business with anyone like just friends wise? And is that tough? What does that dynamic look like?
I wouldn't say I've gone into business with any of my friends just yet, but I've had many conversations about doing stuff in the future, plans that looks promising. But that's something that I'm looking to get into as soon as possible, really.
Okay. And before, you mentioned your mum and your brother talking about you saving your money when you were younger. What were you putting your money, where were you putting your money? Was it in, just in the bank, or was it an investment? Yeah.
Just in like a normal ISA account, to be honest with you. Just like literally just leaving it there, just as soon as I get paid. Bam. In the mum called me, Bevis, have you tried to put the money? Have you done it?
Bro, that's music to Sasha's ears, you know. I can't really stress to you how much.
This microphone. What's wrong with you?
Her soul, wait there. Her soul is smiling so much when you said ISA. I can't believe it. Bro, really? He loves a knife. Yeah, you made her night. Say that for free. You made her night. Go on, Sasha, carry on.
Nothing. I mean, look, I am happy that you put it in an ISA and not just left it in your cash account. Yeah. But Was it a cash ISA, or was it a stocks and shares ISA? Was it ISA with your bank?
Yeah, it was ISA with my bank.
So you did the first part, right? Put it in the wrapper. Yeah. But now we need that money to work for you by moving it into some investments and stocks and shares. So do you dabble in stocks and shares at all?
Or? Not really, to be honest with you. That's probably a conversation that me and you can have after this, to be honest with you, so you can educate me on that. So
that's the main apprehension, like not knowing...
Yeah, for sure. Definitely that. 100%.
Do you know, like, in terms of the change room, so I think when we spoke to another player, he was saying stocks and shares, he doesn't really get into it because he doesn't really know much about it. But within the change room, are there, like, some, like, financial myths that are just floating around? Like, man are saying, just put your peas in this thing here. Hey, and by next month, you'll be a gazillionaire, Bev. Like, anything, man?
Definitely, Definitely, you know, them type of schemes and stuff like that. That
got ACN in that. Hey, shout out ACN one time.
It's crazy. And I've heard like horror stories about them. Like players saying, give you like 5-10 grand, I can flip this and give it to this person, give it to that person, and you come out with nothing and like the person just loses your money.
Bev, is there one you can share? No names, but just like where someone said, yeah, put it in this, the person took the peas, and then just share the story if you can.
That's not really my business to say.
Is it technical? You know, I got a probe though, innit? I've got to ask these questions.
Of course. It's only right.
I hear you, man. Okay. Did you give us an example though of like, in terms of what kind of things? Would it be like in, I don't know, jewelry, in like anything? Just give us some kind of idea what kind of things.
Just like that sort of category, like jewelry, watches.
Okay.
Just stuff along those lines.
Okay.
But I don't really feel I need to know the person if I'm gonna be working with
them. Yeah. 100.
And what he's actually gonna be doing with the money that I'm gonna be giving him.
100.
And vice versa. We have to have a good relationship for me to actually go through with it.
And I'm picking up from some of the conversations that James and I have had that property investment seems to be quite a big theme with footballers. From the inside looking out, why would you say that that's the most common investment for footballers?
I'll say because it's the most safe. You're never going to lose. And as footballers, our career is very short, so we have to look at the long-term goal of our money and our worth, pretty much. So I feel like investing in property is a win-win for us, long-term or short-term. So that's what I would think. That's what I would say.
I hear you still.
And you said that Jose Font spoke to you about going into properties. Is there any players that are coming behind you that you're giving gems to as well, or?
Yeah, definitely. I've had conversations with like young pros that, of course, the money in football is crazy nowadays, so they're going to be in a massive wage from an early age. So I've had conversations with them and just like, I would say, enjoy your money. You're still young. I understand that you want to enjoy it, but be clued up and don't do anything ridiculous like go to Libs and spend like £15,000 on one night out. That's flipping a deposit for a house up north, you know? So, just be clever with it. And just, of course, you're still young. Enjoy it, but be clever with it.
What's like the percentage then, changing room wise? How many people are sensible and saying, know what you're doing? And how many are the £15,000 a night? Like, what's percentage?
I'll say I've got a pretty sensible changing room. Like, there's no like crazy characters that would just.
Yeah, but you have to say that.
Come on, man. There is a crazy character, bruv. We know. There's always one in every change.
There's always crazy characters that just love like a night out and love like going up. Table here, come here, got a table. But that's the thing, that all of us are pretty sensible with our money, especially at the age that we're at.
Word. Another thing you mentioned to me was like, you said you're doing stuff like back home. So you're from Uganda. Talk to us about that. What is that project? What does that look like, bro?
Basically, I've been working with my mum with this product that we're doing. Basically, it's just like this building flats in Uganda.
Okay, property again.
Mainly for my mother as her retirement.
I like you, Bev.
I'm trying to support. I'm trying to support. So, of course, as we get older, our parents are getting a lot older, and ultimately, my mum wants to go back to the motherland, which is only right. So that's something that we're working on now as we speak, and just making sure that's all set up well for when she goes back, she's got some sort of income coming in, so she doesn't have to rely too much on me and my brothers for anything. She can just go back, chill in her house that she's built, and just relax. And that's what I want for her. She deserves it. Right. So all I can do is support that. But that's giving me like my own type of fuel to actually, do you know what? If my mom's doing this and I'm helping her out with this, that, and other, maybe I can just, I don't know, I've got a plot of land there already. Mm-hmm. Maybe I can just do my little project there by myself and see that as a long-term investment. Right. Seeing as I'm going back and forth to Uganda with international football. So that's something I'm very interested in doing, for sure.
And what can you tell the people about international property investment? Because that's like a level up from doing it domestically. So if you could say sort of a benefit and a drawback, or any sort of pitfalls to watch out for, what would you say?
I'll say, especially if you're going to like build in Africa, it's gonna like Africa's gonna be is amazing first and foremost. Like you see that people going to Ghana for like New Year's and like people are using it like a holiday and that.
Tell them. You know why I'm saying that? It's because Seish, yeah, she's obviously one second. Butter doesn't melt right now, yeah. But let me tell you, off the air, pure African slander. Sierra, you have an airport that. Yeah, we do. Yeah, we do.
Like you don't do the same about Jamaica. You're on it every week. So what are you talking about?
They're both great places.
But no, Bev, that's very, very true still. So how many block of flats are you looking to build? And like, do you see it being more than just a project for the mud? Do you see yourself, okay, if this one goes well, you think, okay, cool, this is giving you the incentive to build? And
yeah, definitely. Like, the only problem is with the cons of it is just finding people that you actually trust to do that from a distance. So that's the only problem that I think of, because, you know, people are always trying to, like, kind of pickpocket this, And everybody wants to eat. There's no harm in doing, but everybody wants to eat. That's the only problem I have with doing something like that.
So how did you...
in the past, something like sort of... Have you had something happen to you already in the past that's been not the best experience, or have you managed to dodge it thus far?
Yeah. I've had like a few conversations with my mum, and she's been on the phone. She's been like, she's screaming down the phone, like, how can you do this? How can you do this? Like, this doesn't add up. I've got the paperwork here. This doesn't add up. There's something going on here. Like, I'm going to have to fly out not as soon as I can, but like in the next couple of months to just sort this out properly. And there's been a few situations like that, which of course, being our son, it's a bit uncomfortable to watch. I'm like, okay, the next time I go to Uganda, I need to actually like go and see what's going on. So that's the one situation that I've experienced.
I hear you. And when you're choosing people to work with, is it mainly your mum deciding? Like, how do you filter that process? Because like you said, you could easily get bumped, fam. Man could be like, yeah, come true, I'll give you this. Next minute, he's skating off of your bread.
Luckily, one of my uncles works in construction, and me and him are very tight, very, very tight. So every time I go to Uganda, he comes to like my hotel and just checks up on me. We have conversations, all the family come to the hotel. And so I'm lucky in that sense that he's the actual one person I can actually trust, you know?
I hear it. Keeping it in the family.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
Oh, Bev.
Yes.
If I gave you £100,000 right now, bank transfer, what are you doing with the cash?
What am I doing with the cash?
Yep, what are you doing with it?
What am I doing with the cash? Buy a G-Wagon?
Yes! That's the answer! Yes! Because some people play it safe. Yes, Bev.
I have to check. Wait, are you still driving around in the Corsa? Is it from Corsa to G-Wagon or?
Nah. Upgraded from the Corsa, to be fair. But that's one. That's another thing with cars are cash loss. That's another thing.
Big L's.
I feel like I've wasted so much money on cars. So
bro,
much.
Speak on that a little bit. Yeah.
Yeah. Just like, I remember when I got my second contract, Southampton. To be fair, I was like one of the last people in my team to get like a nice, like you could consider a nice car. And I got like a little A-class.
Yeah, that was nice. The ladies loved that, be real.
Yeah, it was nice at the time. I thought, you know, I've got my contract. My brother was like, okay, Bevis, you can, because he's an accountant. He's like, okay, Bev, you can actually do this. Right. You can do this. So I was like, okay, let me do that. Upgraded. And my manager just came in and grilled me. And I was like, God, like, what's wrong with me? Like, has he seen the car park? Like, by this time I had a course, then I had an Astra that I bought, then I got an A-class. And I was like, I'm literally one of the last people in the 2021s to have a decent car.
Yeah.
Mavis, how dare you come in a car like that? Who do you think you are? You think you've made it already? And I was like, this guy is actually going off. Like, he literally pulled me into the pizza room by myself, just screaming at me, who do you think you are? And I was like, bruh, I'm sorry, but like the car's staying. I'm going for 2 years.
Bro. Bro, that's mad. But put it into context then, like you're saying the car park was nuts. So you got your A class, it's a very nice car, no doubt. But what's everyone else doing then?
Everybody, to be honest, like everybody else before, like I got my A class, had like nice Mercs, BMWs, Audis already. Looking back at the cars park, I'll just say, it's a waste of money, man. They all do exactly the same job, to be honest with you. Literally, all do exactly
looking
the same.
Back, do you regret it now? Or like, you still enjoy the moments in the whip and like you said, spend your money when you can, be sensible, enjoy your peace.
I'll say like, enjoy it. Like I did enjoy it. Like I felt like I deserved it at the time. Like I worked hard for it. And I made sure that I saved enough and I waited for the right opportunity when the contract was good enough for me to do such a thing. So I don't regret it at all. I liked it and I wanted it.
So what's the problem? How can the manager get that intimate with your
balances? Honestly, I think it was just a bit personal. I think there was other things accumulated to make him show up like that. Because honestly, when like after that situation happened, all the other staff members was like, what's actually wrong with him? Like he's just nitpicking on the smallest thing about you. I don't really know what's wrong with him. But it must have been something else, to be honest.
For real, man. In terms of, like you said, saving a little bit, in terms of like ratio of your piece, so how much percentage do you actually think, actually, end of the month, man's going to slap X percentage away? And has that changed since you were younger to now?
Yeah, definitely. I would say as soon as I get paid, I've got like, how many accounts? Four accounts where as soon as I get paid, I put money aside for food for the month. Then money aside for my bills. Then money aside, just put into like Bitcoin or cryptocurrency, because obviously that's going to be the future. So I put money aside for that. And what's going on?
Stage. Don't make that face and explain yourself. Go and chat your chat. It's a free platform.
Like, I've just put money aside there. I was like, to see what happens with it. If it goes up, it goes up. If it goes down, like, it is what it is.
When?
And then I put money straight into my ISA.
What percentage would you say though? 50, 20, or it's hard to...
I'd say 50% goes into...
15, yeah?
50.
Oh, 50?
Yeah.
Into your savings?
My savings straight.
That's wavy. That's wavy. I can't believe that number. That's mad.
Yeah.
Respected.
Was it when you were younger then? When you were back at, when you were first starting out, what would you say the percentage was then?
When I first started out, I was treating myself quite a bit, to be honest with you.
Yeah, holidays. Bev was never in the country. Yeah, holidays.
I would say probably like 40, maybe 40.
Okay, so...
It was still a solid number, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
I wasn't too crazy. I wasn't like a crazy, crazy guy. No, I wasn't too...
Nah. You were never flashy still. I respect it. I do respect it.
So how much do you spend on food per month then?
Dude, I'm a big boy. Probably 500. I think 500 is all right. 400, 500.
That is all right. Don't let us say your facial expression. That is all right.
Per week. How much do you spend on food per month, James?
Not far off that, probably like four.
I think that's reasonable.
Yeah, because you go through like in a week, like it's about £100 you're spending, maybe 125. Like, that's 7 days. That's a lot.
What did you feed in? £100 per week.
Listen, I'll say that. Well, I budget for that.
Thank you.
But if like I don't obviously go over that number, then I'll just top it up when it needs to be topped up.
I understand you. You're a professional athlete.
How much do you spend? How much do you spend?
Maximum £200 a month. Maximum.
Really?
We need to talk about your nutrition off air still, because some things we need to take off. Yeah? We need to just sort that out privately. But that's for a different conversation.
Make your shopping list. You think in advance what meals you're going to make, and then stick to your shopping list, and that's it.
But how about if you want to treat yourself? You want to go out for like a little Nando's or a little Wagamama's? I don't know.
Whatever tickles. If they're included in restaurants, then I won't speak anymore, because obviously the numbers then a bit mad.
Seisha loves upper echelon dining, beef, chicken, everything's there. Like I don't even know about that.
The
I've never even tasted a cheek of a beef. I don't know about them things, but Seisha, she could tell you every single layer of flavor that's going on there. So, all right, cool, man. So we're kind of coming to the back end of the combo. But another thing I really wanted to touch on, I think it's kind of a big trend now. Like, a lot of players are focusing on, like, their own personal brand, like, either doing podcasts or they're doing a lot more media stuff and taking control of their own media. So for you, is it a thing where you're like, okay, this is a long-term strategy? Like, I want to position myself to be able to maybe work in the media. Do you see yourself as maybe trying to get brand deals? What's the thought around being more active with things like this?
It's definitely more popular for, like, athletes to be putting themselves out there a lot more. And obviously, you know me personally, I'm not really out there. I'm more of a private person. But I feel like you kind of have to put yourself out there, especially if you're playing football and you're in the limelight and people are watching your games. And it's a market that we can take advantage of, like the Instagrams and Twitters and all the social media platforms, all the podcasts that are all coming out now, such as yours and other people's that have asked me to be on there. So it's something that interests me with my personal brand and obviously getting noticed in Uganda and playing for Uganda, like, sort of, not even, it's a bit cringy, but kind of celebrity, like, well-known in Uganda. People know my name, so it's a bit like, why not? Why not go for it and just, like, put yourself out there and just, if it works out, it works out. If it doesn't, at least you've tried. So it's definitely something that I want to get into, getting more brand deals and just be more active, you could say, on my social media.
Yeah, facts. So, and I think you're right. I think a lot of people are taking control because I think before you needed another medium to give you a platform to have a voice, right? So you needed your Sky Sports and everyone else. But I think, like, athletes have cottoned onto the fact, actually, I'm the commodity. I'm the thing that people want to tune in to watch. So, like, Ben Foster, you know, when Jam scored on the GoPro. So that thing there is blowing up because he's taking control of his own narrative. He's saying, yeah, boom, like, I'm an athlete. I'm the goalkeeper for Watford. And there's actually a whole audience, a whole fan base that care about that. And I think when Mandem clocked that, that's where the views are. That's when the views, with the views, then comes monetization. And then you can make a little extra on the side for you. So it's good to see that you're cutting onto that fact still.
Definitely. Like, it first happened to me when I first went to international duty. And I literally went to training. The media team were there. They're like, oh, Bevis, you need to come and do an advert for this brand. And I was like, okay. Then one of the other players came up to me and said, Bevis, are you getting paid for this? Make sure you're getting paid for this.
Yeah.
Like, am I meant to be getting paid for this? I don't really know.
Did you get bread or not? I think everyone wants to know. Did you get the piece?
Yeah, I got the bread. Okay. Okay. As soon as the player came up to me and said, make sure. I was like, okay. I'll go ask the question. They said, yeah, like, you're going to get this amount. And I was like,
bro, I feel like you can share that amount, though. It's not your money. It's not your football piece. It's like, it's extracurricular piece. You can tell us that, man. Come on, man.
Hey, you know, you have to keep the thing personal.
Bro, that's the extracurricular ones, bro. That's probably like a milk brand, Milo or something, man. No one worries about that, bro.
It wasn't like a crazy amount of money, too. Yeah. It was like, probably like $3,000 or something.
Yeah, but that's fair.
I was like, I was surprised because when I first went to Israel, I thought I was just playing, like, just play football, nothing, no extras. So when that came along, I was like, oh wow, you can actually, like, make just quick money just like that. So that opened my eyes up to it for sure.
1,000,000%. And I think that $3,000, like, in, like, relatively to what you're earning, think about it, you're only there what, an hour, if that, and to get that percentage, you know what I'm saying, to get that amount of peas for that amount of work, I'm glad, like, you know, it's raw. There's bread in this, you know. Like, I can actually do well, to supplement what I'm doing on the pitch as well. So, I rate it.
It was interesting. It was crazy, to be honest, because I was only, like, how old was I? Maybe 20-ish, 21. So I was like, wow, this is eye-opening.
I like that still. Okay, cool. We are pretty much about to wind up. And say she's got a lovely, lovely quiz section for you.
Game time. How's it going?
Go on.
Game master?
Let's go.
Hey, so I'm going to tell you a fact or not a fact, a statement, and you've got to tell me whether it's fact or fiction, true or false. First one.
Hold on. Seish, give the man a little bit more info. You're going to get 5 questions.
Yeah.
Each one is worth 2 points. The maximum you can get is 10. Do it properly, or don't do it at all, Sish.
That's what you're there for, my little understudy. Thank you. Right. Yeah. First question of five, 2 points on offer. Robbie Fowler has made millions from holding property workshops across the country. True or false?
Property workshops. I know he's got some, he's got Robbie Fowler. He's got a lot of properties. I think that's true.
True. 2 points. James, keep score. 2 points.
Keep score. Two points.
Next one. Marlon Harewood owns a business customizing cars. True. True. Can I finish the question? Yeah, right, true. 4 points. Gattuso opened a butchery.
I'm not too sure about this one. I'm going to say go false.
You're right. He owns a fish shop.
Yeah? That's what he's
saying. Hey, 6 points, man. I like this.
Rio Ferdinand set up his own record label called White Chalk Music.
Oh, I'm not too sure. White Chalk Music. Maybe done that ages ago, but I don't know. I think it's false.
It's true.
Yeah.
Oh. Right, last one. Eric Cantona has acted in over 50 movies.
True.
Oh, false. So is that six, James?
It is six. You got two. So 6 points. Not bad. Not bad. It's not great, Bev. You know that. You have high standards, mate.
Yeah,
that's the standards.
True, man.
It's okay, innit? We'll give you. It's better than average, but you're better. You and I are better than that. But now, listen. Honestly, that has been a very, very insightful conversation. Bevis, I feel like hearing your outlook, you've given us a good balance. You know what I'm saying? You weren't saying you're just hiding your peas underneath your mattress, not doing anything with it. But at the same time, you weren't too frivolous. You weren't doing 15, 20 bags in the club, making it rain. You had a good support network around you and you had a good head on your shoulders. So yeah, big yourself up one time for that, bro.
Appreciate it. Thank you for having me, man. Appreciate it a lot.
No problem at all. Sage, any parting words for the people then? Anything you want to say to Bev, to myself, to yourself?
I don't want to say nothing to you. James, stop eating that microphone. Bev, thanks for your time and dropping the gems on Hustle for today. And I look forward to seeing you do big things.
Thank you, Andrew.
Good luck with your project as well in Uganda.
Thank you very much.
Bev, good luck. Keep doing your thing. Okay, that is it. Another episode of Hustle wrapped up. It's been a genuine pleasure. I've been unbelievable. The other two have been okay. Make sure you do all that good stuff. You're liking, you're sharing, you're commenting, all of that. And look out for the next episode. Peace.